Good morning.
Good morning.
We're glad that you could join us for worship this morning. I see some new faces to me, so it's nice to see you and nice to meet you. We're glad that you could join us for worship. Of course, I'm a new face within the community. My name is Travis Orkoski, and I am honored to be here covering for Pastor Trish while she is on sabbatical. And so we remember her in our prayers, that her time away is life-giving, that she is able to hear the call of the Spirit in her life, and also able to hear the call and the guidance of the Spirit for this community of faith. So as we gather this morning, I wanted to highlight a couple things. Number one, there are announcements located on the website and in the back of the bulletin. I'm not going to put you to sleep with these. I'll put you to sleep with the sermon. Are you awake? Okay, just checking out. And then there is an announcement that we need to make about a special meeting. Scott, there he is.
Participate virtually in order to be eligible in order to vote. So it cannot be
next Sunday, on the 30th, during our gift time period, right after the service. There will also be a presentation to review the results of the land survey that so many of you participated in. Thank you very much. We had over 130 participants. So we will give a summary not only of the quantitative data that was came from that, but also some of the narrative that you shared with us as well, obviously in a combination manner. So please join us the next two weeks as we take our next steps in our wonderful Gloria Dei journey together. Thank you.
As we begin worship this morning, I'm going to invite you to shift gears with me. Have you ever been doing something and then got into it and realized you didn't have all the parts that you need? In our house, things like picking up a used puzzle at the thrift store because we have a 7-year-old that loves puzzles, only to get to the puzzle all together and discover there are 3 or 4 pieces missing. Or maybe it's the knot planner in the house, starting to make the meal that he decided to make on a whim, only to discover 2/3 of the items that he needed to make the meal are not there. Or maybe you're a project person and you're working on something in the garage. You start it, maybe you took it apart to repair it, and you come back to it years later. The pieces are missing. Have you ever had that moment or that experience? The incompleteness is an image I invite you to think about. Those will be images that we come back to in our lessons for today. And maybe there's a space where God is inviting us to see beyond our reality to something greater. So as we begin, I invite you to take a few moments to sit with that image on your heart. Let that be the meditation. And pray that the Spirit is at work here in this midst, that we are God's faithful people in all that we do. We begin with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates us, redeems us, and calls us by name. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and in the presence of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and your beloved children. We have turned our faces away from your glory, where it did not appear as we expected. We have rejected your word when it made us confront ourselves. We have failed to show hospitality to those you call us to welcome. Accept our repentance for the things we have done and for the things we have not done. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us and lead us, so that we may bathe in the glory of your Son, born among us, and reflect your love for all of creation. Amen. Friends, rejoice in the good news. In Christ Jesus, your sins are forgiven. You are descendants of the Most High, adopted into the household of Christ, and inheritors of eternal life. Live as freed and forgiven children of God. Amen. And we begin with our opening hymn. Thank you. with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Blessed Lord God, you have caused the Holy Scriptures to be written for the nourishment of your people. Grant that we may hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that covered with all your promises, we may be in grace and prepare our whole fast to the hope of eternal life. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
The first lesson is from the 8th chapter of Nehemiah. Ezra reminds the returned exiles that the joy of the Lord is your strength. Nehemiah 8, verses 1 through 3, 5 through 6, and 8 through 10. All the people of Israel gathered together into the square before the water gate. They told the scribe Ezra to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had given to Israel. Accordingly, the priest Ezra brought the law before the assembly, both men and women and all who could hear with understanding. This was on the first day of the seventh month. He read from it facing the square before the water gate from early morning until midday, in the presence of the men and the women and those who could understand. And the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was standing above all the people. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. Then Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, Amen, Amen, lifting up their hands. Then they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. So they read from the book, from the law of God, with interpretation. They gave the sense so that the people understood the reading. And Nehemiah, who was the governor, and Ezra, the priest and scribe, and the Levites who taught the people, said to all the people, This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. Then he said to them, Go your way, eat the fat and drink sweet wine, and send portions of them to those for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy to our Lord, and do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. This is the word of the Lord. The second lesson is from the 12th chapter of 1 Corinthians. For this struggling congregation in Corinth, Paul delivers a vital message of unity that is a mark of the church today. 1 Corinthians 12, verses 12 through 31a. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with great honor, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it, and God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various forms of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts. This is the word of the Lord.
Turned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding countries. He began to teach in synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll and he gave it back to the attendant and he sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. What a loaded group of texts for one Sunday morning. Either it's a preacher's delight or it's a preacher's nightmare. You can bring all these images together and try to explain it and watch everybody fall asleep, or you can focus on one and risk missing some things along the way. We're back in year C, as I mentioned, 2 weeks ago. Last week, we jumped to the Gospel of John. This week, we jump back into Luke, and we learn of the story of Jesus after his baptism. Did you catch that first verse? Did you notice the actor that was present? Jesus then filled with the Spirit. Return to Galilee. We know that in the Gospel of Luke, the Spirit showed up at Jesus' baptism. And from that point forward in the story, we learn that things are changed. Luke tells us the Spirit is present with Jesus and informs his ministry and all that he does. We've shifted, or dare I say, in the language of our world today, in the Gospel of Luke, we've made a pivot. And Luke is then clear to say in our gospel lesson today what the presence of the Spirit looks like and how that will inform Jesus' ministry in the world. He will bring good news to the poor, sent to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. These are things that could make for an interesting story. And as we walk through the Gospel of Luke the rest of this year, we'll see how that plays out. But there's something more with the Gospel of Luke that it's really easy to forget. And it's part of that two-volume set, right? I talked about this a couple weeks ago. That the author of Luke is also believed to be the author of the book of Acts. And so if you take these two stories and you set them together, we get a much bigger or fuller perspective of what's going on in the church. The Gospel of Luke is the presence of Spirit with Jesus. And our gospel lesson today talks about that. And the book of Acts is a reminder of the gift of Pentecost and the gift of Holy Spirit on the church. And then we learn what it means to be a church powered by the Spirit into the world as we encounter the rest of that story. But what if we think about today's New Testament lesson, the Apostle Paul is talking about in light of the second half of the story? The same Spirit that was present with Jesus at his baptism and in his ministry is given to the early church. Do we make the connection that Paul is part of that early church? Do we think about when we read Paul's lessons that he understands that same Spirit that was present with Jesus, that was present with the disciples in the early church, was present with him, and that same Spirit is present with the church today? That's a really, really big picture perspective that might give us some insights. So for Paul, in our lesson today, we pick up where we left off with that 1 Corinthians 12, verses 12 through 31a. Paul understands that the church, the body of Christ, which he spells out the importance of the parts, Paul understands that the church in those parts is only possible. Yeah. The church is only possible because the Spirit had been gifted to the church. Paul then invites us to think about how each of the parts are essential in that body. And without one or without another, things might be incomplete. Takes me back to the missing puzzle piece, right? You can only see a part of the picture if there are pieces missing. Now, there's danger in taking any image too far. And we get so focused on one particular part that we zero in and miss the bigger picture. And I think what Paul is ultimately inviting us into in this text today is this. The Spirit, the Holy Spirit that was present with Christ at his baptism, was present with the early church at Pentecost, that was present in the church in Corinth, that is present with us in the waters of baptism, that same Spirit is here in our midst too. Now, if you're like me, I guess that you might wrestle with what the Holy Spirit looks like. If we talk about being the church of the Holy Spirit, how do we explain it? Anybody have any suggestions? Yeah, and maybe that's the hard part about living life in the Spirit. It seems almost abstract where we want something tangible. We want something to hold on to. We want something real. Jesus is pretty easy to wrap our head around, right? Son of God, on earth, baptized, loved all that he encountered, died on the cross, reveals God's love for us. Man, the Holy Spirit just for me often seems just beyond my grasp. And maybe Paul is saying it's not our job to grasp the Spirit. Maybe Paul's invitation in today's text is to simply this: trust that the Spirit has made us who the Spirit needs in this place. Trust that the Spirit has drawn the parts of the body to do God's work here and now. Trust that we are who God needs us to be. Along with that, do you ever feel like I do? Do you ever wrestle with trying to figure out what part of the body that you are? One of the things that's really been a challenge for me as the pastor is people say, well, you're the pastor. You're such an important part of the body. Okay. But I also know that if there are other parts of the body missing, the body is incomplete. And so how do we, as Paul reminds us, to step back and remember that the body is the sum of its parts? It's not one or a few key parts. My grandfather was diabetic, severely diabetic. And I was in first grade at the time, and long story short, he had a leg amputated. And I remember him trying to learn to walk without the leg. He got the prosthesis. It did the job well. He was able to walk eventually with a cane, but it was never the same. I bring the story up because it was that first lesson where I really grasped at such a young age that the way the parts of our body work together. And we almost take that for granted. Have you known anybody that's lost a limb? Have you known anybody that's had a stroke and they've gone through rehab to learn to walk or talk? To these, to me, are everyday reminders of the way of all the parts of the body work together in ways that we don't even realize. How did you learn to ride a bicycle? How do you learn to balance? How do you explain to a child? Kids, how do you learn to ride a bike? You just learn how to ride the bike, right? That's a reminder of the way all the parts of the body work together for something beyond their individual ability. I'm grateful to walk with you as members of the body of Christ. I'm honored to walk with you as you share the journey of faith. I'm honored to cover Sunday mornings while Pastor Trish has space to listen for the Spirit in our midst. I'm amazed to hear the stories of the way you as a community of faith are working to be Christ's church in the world. And so maybe today's message is an affirmation to us as the church in this place and time. Maybe we're doing the right thing. Maybe we're on the right track. Maybe we are embracing being the body of Christ and knowing that God is at work in here and now. And maybe the best thing that we can do is trust that the Spirit brought us together will be the same Spirit that continues to carry us forward. Brothers and sisters, my prayer for you as a community of faith is that you trust God's wisdom in all that you do, that you know God's life-giving Spirit is present in your midst, and that you boldly and you faithfully live each day following the calling of the church, that is, messengers of God's love for the world. Amen.
Please join me as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, who was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance. So we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all that God has made. You reveal yourself to us in the reading of Scripture. Fulfill your word through the faithful witness of your church. Send us out into the world to bring your liberating good news to all people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Creation proclaims your handiwork. Teach us to love the intricate and beautiful bodies that you have created. Bless tiny insects, enormous whales, and every creature in between. Sustain species at risk of extinction. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You desire that there be no dissension among us. Where we are divided in our society, in our nation, or in our world, come quick to reunite us into one body. Ease conflict, dispel violence, and bring an end to war. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Anoint with your Spirit all who seek your favor. Grant provision and justice for the people living in poverty, people living with disability, those living with pain, or those living under oppression. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Build up the body of Christ in this place. Bless the variety of ministries in this congregation. Empower us to freely welcome and deeply value each person who enters into worship and ministry among us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In thanksgiving, we lift before you the saints whom the praise of the promise of salvation has now been fulfilled. Tend to all those who mourn. Bring us together in your everlasting glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Since we have such great hopes in your promises, O God, we lift these and all of our prayers to you in confidence and faith. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Know that as you remove the seal over the bread and you eat the body of Christ, that it is the body of Christ given for you. And as you remove the seal over the wine or the juice and you drink, know that it is the body of Christ shed for you. May the body and blood of Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
And let us pray. We give you thanks, most gracious God, for we have feasted on the abundance of your house. Send us to bring good news to proclaim your favor to all. Strengthen with the richness of your grace in your Son, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And receive our Lord's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And we conclude with our final hymn.
Thanks be to God. I invite you to share the peace of Christ with those gathered here today.